wanted to thank everyone for coming to this event. It's a brand new thing for us in the library. My name is Jana. I'm a librarian here at the Shaw Library. And this program is a partnership between the DC Public Library and the Maryland Institute College of Art Curatorial Practice Program. So does anyone know who Watha T. Daniel is? Okay. So Watha T. Daniel was born in 1911. He was a local Shaw resident. He's most well known as the chairman of the DC Model Cities Commission. He was also vice president and chairman of the Model Inner City Community Organization, MICCO. He participated in numerous boards and commissions in the district, including the Central Northwest Civic Association and the Mayor's Advisory Commissions on Health and Criminal Justice. So he was a master plumber by profession. He was the first African American appointed by the DC to the DC Plumbing Board. And his work as chairman of the Model Cities Commission targeted inner city renewal in areas especially decimated by the King riots of 1968, which included Shaw, Stanton Park, and Trinidad. He died December 8th, 1973, weeks before the Home Rule Act passed, which was December 24th, 1973, and which gave, of course, DC residents the power to elect their own mayor and council, which he had advocated long before it became reality. Symphony in DC major. It's by a local artist named Zachary Oxman. Over here we have, of course, Duke Ellington, then Robert Goldshaw, and then a local artist named Alma Thomas. We're going to have our fantastic poet Reggie Kabiko perform a poem here for you.
Excellent. Well, Jana asked me to be here. I thought I should perform my feel-good identity poem. People ask me where I'm from all the time. And so I wish I could just like play this poem. So I welcome all of you here. This is for everyone who's had to check a box. The government asks me to check one if I want money. I say, how could you ask me to be one race? I stand proudly before you, a fierce Filipino who knows how to belt hard gospel songs played to African drums at a Catholic mass, and loving the music to suffering beats and lashes from Banzais on the Capitol streets. Southeast DC with its sleepy crime, my mother nursed patients from 7 to 9, patients gray from the railroad riding past civil rights. I walked their tracks when I entertained them at the chapel and made their canes pillars of percussion to my heavy gospel. My comedy out loud, laughing about our shared stolen experiences of the South. Would it surprise you if I told you my blood was delivered from north of Portuguese vessels who gave me spiritual stones and the turn in my eyes, my father's name when they conquered the Pacific Isles? My hair is black and thick as Negrito, growing abundant as Sampaguita, flowers defying civilization like Filipino pygmies that dance on the mountain. I could give you an epic about my ways of life for my look, and you want me to fill it in one square box? How could you tell me to fill Gilgamesh with all of its waters in one square box? From what shape or integer do you count existing identities? Grant loans for the mind or Crayola white census sheets? There's no one kind to fill for anyone. You tell me who I am. What gets the most money, and I'll sing that song like a one-man caravan. I know arias from Naples, Tunis and Accra, lullabies from welfare, food stamps and nature. And you want me to sing one song? I have danced jigs with Jim Crow and shuffled my hips to the sonic guitar of Clapton and Hendrix, waltzed with dead lovers, skipped to bamboo sticks, ballet kabuki and mime katakali, arribadirchi the rumba and tap tin pan alley. And you want me to dance the Bhagavad Gita on a box too small for a Thumbelina thin diva? I'll check other. Thank you very much. Oh my God, I feel like I'm doing the inaugural poet presentation. But I'm right here on 7th Street and P. Thank you so, so much.
This is an Art in the Hood project that I put together. It's a monument that we're creating to a really amazing event that happened in Washington, D.C. last century. It's a portrait of an ensemble from Chicago, known as the Art Ensemble of Chicago. They came to Washington and they went into the building that we had arranged to do their concert, and they were carrying what they called their full force tour. Which was five musicians that played 20 saxophones and literally 100 percussion instruments, gongs, bells, whistles, every kind of toy you could imagine. And they unloaded into the pension building. And all of you probably know it today. You've been to the National Building Museum. Well, these guys walked in and they're literally the most percussive ensemble on the planet, and at least American ensemble on the planet. And they started setting up and rehearsing and realized that there was hundreds of them because of the echo in this building. And we're calling this mural the Art Ensemble of Chicago versus the Pension Building, because they went on to fight it out all night long and made some of the most magical sounds you've ever imagined. When you go in that building, you could imagine if there were five people beating on 100 drums, what it would have sounded like. The DC Alley Museum started up last year, and I think you've seen most everything else, right?
There's a Carnegie Woods and House, which you can also visit to introduce Joseph Green.
I work for an organization called Split This Rock, which is a social justice and arts organization, and I run their youth programming. The reason I chose this poem, because it was the first poem I wrote in D.C. This poem was written a month after the murder of Trayvon Martin, and it deals with such issues. This poem is called Hands and is dedicated to my son. Today, I am doused in guilt, and I don't know what to do with these hands. Facebook and Twitter have informed me that my friends have joined together in digital solidarity to fight for our rights or your memory, or so this never happens again. Photos from the front line of our most righteous of selves, inspirational memes and hashtags. I realize this has happened before. I wonder, if I listen to the recordings of your murder, will I feel anything different to me? Your life and death is no more than a Facebook update, a trending topic on Twitter. Hashtag, I hope somebody is praying for your mother. Hashtag, is it okay to talk about gun control now? Hashtag, what is the meaning behind all of this? Hashtag, all black bodies look alike until they're murdered. I am overwhelmed. by the irrational rantings of a society too busy arguing about whether or not black lives are important enough to fight for, to actually fight for black lives. But as I stand here ranting, I realize it's because I don't know what to do with these hands that must hold and protect my son. They are not bulletproof. They are made of the same brown material that have seen so many murdered. But before I bow at the altar of suburban flight, I realize that somewhere, somebody is still crying for you. That somewhere, a black mother is gathering all the suspicious clothing her children own, dressing the scarecrow in the front yard, and burning our post-racial society in effigy. That somewhere, a black female is being followed in a Macy's on suspicion of being black. That somewhere, hands up, please don't shoot. That somewhere, why did you shoot me? You told me to get my ID. That somewhere, I'm sorry my music is too loud for you to hear my humanity. That somewhere, I still can't breathe. That somewhere, they're toasting the man who did this to you, and the clans are gathering. Only this time they won't be wearing hoods. They'll be dressed in suits, cloaked by law, charged with progressing the doctrine that if you do not look like you belong here, you can be murdered. That if you look like you belong here, you can be murdered. I will not always be able to protect my son. I pray that by then, black children and fear, black women and violence, black queer and endangered, black male and thug, black bodies and deceased are no longer synonyms. At night, when I take my three-year-old son's clothes off, I say, hands up, Henry. He thinks we are playing a game. I pray that when the time comes, he will know what to do with his hands. Thank you.
Which I remember because I was like a year after I was born, so I'm slightly older than them. So this is the location. It's been here since. It's been here a long time.
As Jenna mentioned, my name is Jennifer Ray. There is a special place in my heart for DC, and particularly the Shaw community. So the poem I'm about to tell you or show case for you today is called Map Lesson. It's the first time I'm performing it, so I hope you enjoy. In my senior year of high school, my math teacher once said, try not to become a statistic, because a low-income inner-city kid like you have low odds of becoming anything more than just a statistic, but I beg to differ. And little did I know that I would be the one teaching a math lesson in Mr. Hendel's second period, but there was a lesson to be learned. See, I am proud to be a statistic, a product of a low-income inner-city environment divided by crack pipe lines drawn in blood red and police blue, with the remainder of us left to pick up the pieces. And pick up the pieces we did, because we knew the formula to success was to work through our struggles. So I am proud to be a statistic, deemed by society as a double negative, black and a woman, but a negative plus a negative equals a positive, so I guess the fact that I am a black woman is a plus. So I'm sorry if your math doesn't add up. See, I am proud to be a statistic, raised to the highest power and uplifted by my community. Without them, I am absolute zero, but with them, I am infinite. Call me statistically significant, greater than, not equal to what society thinks I'm supposed to be, because to be a statistic doesn't always mean something bad. I guess that's why I never left my future up to chance. So I stand proud as a statistic, a standard deviation from a systematic equation. So I guess to figure out the problem, we must solve for why. Like why we are measured by standards that were never intended for us, and why we are assigned values that are worth much less, not even based on who we are. So I guess it seems that society has their numbers wrong, because while I am a low-income inner-city kid, statistics show that I am so much more. So today, class, I hope you learned that not all angles are right, and that others might only see a fraction of what you're worth, but know that you can do the math. Add all you have to offer minus the limits placed on others, limits placed by others, and know you are more than the average. You are a function of what you will become, and you are greater than the sum of your parts. And that sets you apart, because you are a part of a community, no, a family, who knows the formula to your success is through your struggles. And that's why I am proud to be a statistic, a low-income, inner-city, black woman, slightly cute statistic, and you should be proud to be a statistic because we earned it. Thank you.
All right. I hope you're all having a beautiful time and a beautiful day.
I wrote this poem a year ago after the death of Freddie Gray in Baltimore. And I had the honor to perform it with the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra over the backdrop of Sam Cooke's Change Gonna Come. And the title of the poem is A Change Soon to Come. My people are running like the river, raging against a current for a change that always seems soon to come. A change that seems tangible, but it seems that change hasn't managed to want us as badly, so cycles repeat. As soon as George Zimmerman's freedom settled into our dark realities, the brother Eric Gardner couldn't breathe. And more boys in blue have gone free, carrying the last will and testimony of the deceased. The dead portrayed as beasts before their bodies are even cleared from the concrete. The water in this creek is rising. It's threatening to spill over into the streets, but can you blame them? I mean, can you blame it? Because no one ever seems to blame the river for overflowing. They blame the rain. They blame the government for not putting the appropriate programs and policies in place, for not anticipating conditions that would make a river rage. Still, they say that a change is soon to come. So we reply to centuries of brutality with a hashtag. We run to social media to inform and inspire, but a pound sign ain't never brought a black man back. Names trend on social media while mainstream media distorts the facts. Trayvon was killed for snacking while black. Tamir Rice was shot before a substantial question was asked, and perhaps we will never know what happened to Sandra Bland. Freddie Gray, he made eye contact, and then he was arrested for carrying a concealed weapon, but hours later, it was his spine that was severed. And we watched the city grieve over construction or destruction to abandoned buildings when my people's spine had been broken for a minute. Battered from a hard life in a hard city, handcuffed to poverty, shackled to failing schools, backs bent under the weight of gentrification and minimal resources for the poor among us, Baltimore is running. Chicago is running, DC is running, hoping for better days, tripping over Ferguson, Missouri along the way. They're protesting for proportionate policing and a day in court instead of a day in the morgue. For police to stop and help with a flat tire instead of it always being a ticket and a charge, my people are running. Running in fear of death, running away from poverty, running for peace, and then getting knocked down to their knees. Was it prayer that the brother Mike Brown was saying when the sixth shot entered his body, his head already bowed and his knees to the concrete? I wonder if he too thought that a change was soon to come. A change that taunts us from around the corner, from the White House lawn, from recently reconstructed districts where the wealthy among us have dog parks and the poor have blue lights and abandoned buildings. Now you tell me that my people are not resilient. To wake up every day and still have the audacity to be beautiful and brilliant, to know that black lives kind of sort of do matter, but still have the audacity to be beautiful and brilliant, to still have passion enough to fight. And though their protest does not sound as poetic as mine, I am proud of their audacity to move on in the face of a change that is still only soon to come.
All right.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you so much. Mike's gonna cut out occasionally.